coming up on this edition of Southwest TV News. October 17th marks the official legalization of recreational use of marijuana in Canada. And leading up to this, the Saskatchewan Liquor and Gaming Association has issued 51 licenses for retailers across the province, including two in Swift Current. Electric vehicles are becoming more common in the marketplace, and a provincial group recently stopped over in Swift Current.
These mugs, saucers, and bowls all share something in common. They are rich, brilliant, and colorful, and are the works of artist Nick Seville.
Thanks for joining us here today. As the new marijuana law takes effect across the country later this fall, municipalities such as the city of Swift Current are preparing for a new retail market. October 17th marks the official legalization of recreational use of marijuana in Canada. And leading up to this, the Saskatchewan Liquor and Gaming Association has issued 51 licenses for retailers across the province, including two in Swift Current. And as these new cannabis retailers prepare to set up shop in the city, concerns have already been raised by the center. The facility is located on First Avenue Northeast and is open to students grades 6 through 12, offering counseling, meals, and other programs to youth dealing with various life challenges from drugs and alcohol and other issues in the home. And as the center follows its mandate of creating a positive environment for youth, its executive director says their voice needed to be heard by City Council.
Well, we were hoping to keep those retail shops as far away from the center as we possibly can. In our conversations with the city, we realized very quickly that they were going to be coming. And, you know, as soon as we realized we didn't really have much of a say in that, you know, our next direction was to say, how far can we keep it from the center? Because, you know, having a cannabis shop next door or across the street or just down the block is really counterproductive to what we're trying to do. Our rules here at the center are no drugs, no alcohol, no bullying, harassment, and respect each other on the property. And having no drugs near the center is absolutely at the forefront of what we're trying to do here. Having the cannabis shop in town might not be in our control, but we want to just use the voice that we have to advocate for the youth and the parents and the families that trust us with the kids here.
Meanwhile, the city of Swift Current indicates it heard the center's concerns loud and clear and has since updated its bylaw for cannabis retailers in the downtown area.
It was to make a discretionary use instead of just a blanket approval within that area. Part of that process then is that the city sends letters out to everybody who's located within a 75-meter radius of the proposed site. And all of those people get to have input into whether or not they have an issue with that particular use being located in the area. And then it comes back to council, where obviously there's lots of input that goes into that as well. So essentially that's the extra layer that we've added to the process, is just to make sure that we're getting this right.
City officials further add that the new cannabis retailers have also been made aware of who their neighbors are in the downtown core and the procedures which need to be followed.
Certainly they were made aware of the fact that the center was located in that area. At the time, I believe what the discussion was that they weren't particularly interested in being located right next to the center in any event, but that wouldn't prevent somebody from doing it down the road. So, you know, it was a good point that the center and east side brought up, and we adjusted accordingly. But for the retailers on the other side, you know, business always seeks certainty. And if we have to jump over a couple more hurdles here at the beginning to provide hopefully a little bit more certainty in our process down the road, I think that's probably a better thing in the long run for the retailers as well.
And in the coming weeks, as marijuana is legalized and the retailers are set up in their desired locations in Swift Current's downtown, the team at the center will be keeping a watchful eye as the situation unfolds.
It's definitely going down the right path, and to give businesses a voice to basically say whether they want it there or not, you know, is really important. Sometimes this can be very detrimental to a business and how they operate, such as ours. You know, we want to make sure that that it's obviously fair in the community for people other than ourselves to have a voice. We're not going to be pushing this aside anytime soon. And it's something that we're used to dealing with. It's something that we want to continue just to do the absolute best we possibly can.
As of production time for this story, only one of the two licensed cannabis retailers for Swift Current has secured a location in the downtown core. Southwest TV News will continue to follow this story as it unfolds. Going green is a popular trend for many, and electric cars were recently in the spotlight in Swift Current. Electric vehicles are becoming more common in the marketplace, and a provincial group recently stopped over in Swift Current. National Drive Electric Week creates awareness of the growing trend of electric vehicles and charging stations across Canada. And electric cars are not only a greener alternative, but also easier on your wallet. For a mere $10, you can travel on the road for 395 kilometers, with some models taking you as far as 460 kilometers before your next charge.
Yeah, lots of room.
And the momentum for electric cars is becoming more popular across Saskatchewan, with additional charging stations being introduced.
There's 41 in the province currently. Last year, this time, there was only 20. So it's doubled in 1 year. And the year before, there was only 10. So I can see next year realistically being 80 chargers in Saskatchewan.
Lloyd Fair not only has a charging station at his business, but also owns two electric cars, including one which he built.
I have a 1986 Porsche, and I converted it to an electric car. And I spent about a year researching and figuring out all the things you needed. The actual build was about 6 months, you know, figuring out all the things. I can go to Weimar and back, no problems at all. I only drive it in the summer because, well, it's a Porsche and it's got a little bit too much power for winter. It spins a little bad. I just wanted to be that guy who said, yeah, I built an electric car. I was curious about it. I saw electric vehicles and I went, I can do that.
Economical cars, which are not only good for the environment, but can take you from 0 to 60 in 4 seconds, while taking you to your desired destination year-round.
It's got a battery that you can get about 60 to 80 kilometers out of on a single charge by plugging into a house or a charger. And when the battery is exhausted, there's a little gas generator, a four-cylinder gas generator that just starts up, purrs away, and feeds the car for another 500 kilometers.
I have this size of car, the battery size, because I travel more, and so I wanted to make sure that I could go. In the winter, you have to be a little more calculating about the distance that you can travel, because it takes more energy to heat the battery so that they operate. And also you want a little heat in the car, and your feet maybe, the windshield, so it takes more. So you have to be a bit more calculating about the distance you can go.
To date, numerous sites across the country have charging stations for electric vehicles, including all PV Marts and IKEAs, while not only welcoming e-vehicles, but assisting in ecotourism. The scenic landscape of the Frenchman River Valley has proven to be a great inspiration for an East End artist. We find out more in this report.
What defines something as a work of art? Is it a painting or a sculpture? Must it be on public display? Does it need to evoke an emotional response? Perhaps even more importantly, do you need to be an artist to create it? These mugs, saucers, and bowls all share something in common. They are rich, brilliant, and colorful, and are the works of artist Nick Seville. Living in the picturesque community of East End, this unassuming blue building is Nick's workshop. And these 20 bowls represent Nick's latest project, a paint party, in which participants use the 20 color combinations represented by these bowls to create their very own work of art.
Basically, it's you choosing your colors and you doing your bowl, and it'll be the only one ever like it. And
created using white clay, each piece takes on Nick's brand of colors.
People can find what they want.
Something he's worked on to perfect.
The clay is really white. It's a blend of porcelain and white clay, so that helps you get bright colors. And then my glazes, I call them flavors. I brush them all on, so I have a lot more input. And also I buy the glazes because they are very colorful. And then you experiment and mix them together and do one on top of the other on top of the other, and do a lot of experimenting.
Like many others, Nick has toiled away at his art, first as a hobby, but then realizing it could become something more. So in 2014, he started his business and hasn't looked back. And now, in this latest chapter, has hopes of creating memorable experiences for tourists as well as for others, seeking just a taste of what it means to be an artist.
Well, this brings to a close another episode of Southwest TV News, reporting the stories that matter to you. We always welcome your news tips. You can always reach us here by phone at our studio or by email to contact us at southwesttvnews.com. Also, be sure to join us daily online for the latest news from across Southwest Saskatchewan and so much more at southwesttvnews.com. And be sure to follow us on a range of social media. Thanks for joining us here today. I'm Carol Andrews.